Trevor, how did it come that you designed the machine with 16D registers?
Well, we first mastered the problems associated with a single register and then realized that we could put in 16 words into one adding unit, thereby multiplying the capacity of the adder.
Yes, it seems a pity really that more modern machines haven't got quite so many D registers or index registers as CSIRAC.
Yes, this is so. Only recently, when designers have been aiming at running more than one program at a time, have the number of registers increased markedly.
This is the computer CSIRAC. It was the first fully automatic electronic digital computer to be built in Australia. It was constructed in the radio physics division of the Commonwealth Scientific and Industrial Research Organisation to the designs of Mr. Trevor Pearcey and Mr. Maston Beard. Mr. Pearcey was responsible for the logical design of the circuitry, and Mr. Baird engineered the electronic components. This computer is of advanced electronic design for its day, and it has a very flexible command code. We are fortunate to have Mr. Pearcey with us now, its designer. And Trevor, perhaps you could relate to us some of the ideas that you had when you designed the machine.
The automatic digital computer, which CSIRAC is a very early example, was initially the product of the pooling of ideas by the mathematician and the electronic engineer, who brought the ideas of the mathematician to physical realization. Three basic principles are involved in the automatic digital computer. One, that the fast computer must be provided with a sufficient internal store so as to be able to hold its program, that is, the sequence of operations which it is instructed to perform. The second is that data and program are formally identical and are in fact held within the same store. The third is that program must consist of a network of sequences of instructions, and that the computer traverse this network in a manner which is determined by the partial answers. In this way, the computer is given the facility for discriminating between differing conditions, the conditions being those which it has already computed, and to thereby repeat the program frequently, but in slightly different form. Soon after World War II, the need arose in the Division of Radio Physics of what was then CSIR for both a more rapid computing capability and for continued development of the electronic pulse techniques which had been developed for radar during World War II. Digital computing, it was seen, would serve both these purposes. In 1948, the division undertook the study of automatic digital computing, and in 1951, CSIRAC, this machine, was actually exhibited publicly in operating order, and has since then been in regular service for the best part of a period of 13 years. During some of this time, it has been improved, and during the last 9 years of its life, has been used as a teaching and research machine in the University of Melbourne. The design, although using engineering methods which have now been rendered obsolete by the invention of the transistor, concentrated upon logical functions which would render it easy to use, and some of them have been incorporated in machines to this day. A set of 20 binary digits tells the machine how to move one particular datum from one part of the machine to another, at the same time carrying out a simple operation upon it, such as addition. The program which it performs consists of a set of such simple transfers of data with appropriate transformations during their passage. The main store of CSIRAC and most of the incidental registers consists of a number of acoustic delay lines. These take the form usually of pipes containing mercury, each one about 5 feet long, down which acoustic waves travel, taking a time of about 1 millisecond. When they reach the far end of the pipe, they are detected, amplified, and recirculated to the starting point. By this means, CSIRAC was able to store 756 items of data, that is 6 decimal digit items or the equivalent, and to be able to operate upon them 1,000 times a second. This is indeed slow compared with 500,000 operations a second, which are now on current machines. Its main medium for accepting programs and data is paper tape of two kinds. One, a wide kind with 12 channels, frequently used for recording programs, and one of 5 channels, identical with paper tape used in common telegraphic equipment. Program and data are coded automatically by special devices with typewriter type of keyboard, and the machine can read these types at about 100 rows per second, or 20 5-decimal-digit numbers. Output onto similar tape is slower at about 6 5-decimal-digit numbers, or the equivalent, and these are printed out after punching at a later stage on similar keyboard instruments. CSIRAC has now been rendered obsolete by recent developments in electronics, and problems have grown too large to be held within it and too time-consuming to run. Problems are common now which can only be performed on equipment of vastly greater size and speed, computing and storage capacities being at least 500 times that of CSIRAC, with correspondingly fast input and output devices. These are all now currently available and are being installed throughout Australia. Here you see a program being recorded on wide paper tape. An instruction written by the programmer in a fairly simple computer language on his sheets of paper is transcribed through the keyboard, and you will notice that 2 keys are depressed before a punching action takes place. An instruction then consists of 2 groups of 10 binary digits. Thank you. The program has now been put onto paper tape, and we will put it onto the reader. For this purpose, for the purpose of this description, there is no data on the paper tape. This tape reads the 12 holes row by row and is operated photoelectrically.
We're going to feed the tape now into CSIRAC, and I press the appropriate control buttons on the console, and the tape is inched forward until we position it into the buffer register at the right spot. Now the bootstrap tape is going in, and the tape is moving into the reader. You can actually see it go into the memory, filling up the cells of the memory by switching on the console keyboard. We can see the tape in position in store. It's loaded into the memory, and we now set the data for the problem, and I am setting this on the keyboard registers. This is the numbers that have to be fed to the program. I fed that number into the machine, and now the next number goes in, and I start the button here, and the calculations takes place, and you'll see the results coming out on punch paper tape from the paper tape punch at this stage. Now I can see inside the memory tubes and watch the arithmetic registers in action. You can see the counting being done in the D registers, and you can see the accumulator calculating, adding and subtracting and so on. This array of cathode ray oscilloscopes is not evident on more modern machines. Because of the older type of machine, these display tubes were present so one could do program testing. Now we're putting the results from that calculation into the flexowriter, which is going to print out the results for us. And we feed it into the reading device here, and we press the start read here, and the tape will run into the flexowriter, and the printing of the codes on the tape now takes place. This is a loan repayment schedule. The loan is being amortized over several years. This is the principal outstanding at the beginning of the first quarter. This column shows the interest at 6% payable for the quarter, and this is the amount being paid off the loan. As the loan schedule goes, of course, the interest becomes less each quarter and the repayment is greater. And this is then done by the machine in a few minutes, but on a desk machine, of course, this will take quite a long time. The program stays in the machine, and a different loan can be calculated by just pressing the next parameters in for the loan amount. Now we're coming to the final payment, and the machine will add up the complete total of all the interest paid in the first column and the complete amount of money paid off the loan. And this, of course, balances with the outstanding amount of the first quarter.
I have said that CSIRAC was easy to use. Let me illustrate by mentioning a few points of its design. From the operator's point of view, the display of the operations is comprehensive and convenient. The state of the store and the arithmetical registers were shown as arrays of spots or traces on small cathode ray tubes, and the state of the control system was made visible as rows of lights on the panels in front of the control console. A switchboard provided facilities for manual control of a program and for insertion of requisite data while the program was running, other than the data which was provided on the punch paper tapes.
Well, that is the story of CSIRAC. This machine, which is still in operation, is perhaps the oldest at present in the world, and it is fitting that this machine is to be stored in the Applied Science section of the National Museum. It will be a historic exhibit, and lots of people in the future should gain much information about early days in computing from the presence of CSIRAC in the museum. We are very pleased it is going there because this machine has been used for hundreds of computations in research projects and been used to teach many students in the University of Melbourne.